Welcome back, everybody, here to the Join Dota Studio as we go into game number two of our best of three between Arrow as well as Invasion Esports. I'm Toby One, your host for our English live stream today, doing SCA quarterfinal qualifiers for WEC. Into the game we go. I am joined by Owie 2000, the man with a really fucked up body clock. But welcome back to the broadcast, man.
Hey, thanks.
You get to repair it soon, though.
I do. Well, it's not showing how fucked up it is now. It's only like 12:30, but like.
Oh, that's fine then. What were you complaining before? Like going to sleep at like 12 o'clock, 1 o'clock in the morning. That's okay.
The thing is, like, for practice for me, I have to wake up at like 8 or 7, 8-ish, 8, 9, depending on like how tryhard we are at the moment.
Because that's when all the Russians would start their first practice.
Yeah, like, scrims are basically usually like 16, 17 CET to like 24 CET-ish. Like, that's the time frame. So for a US West player, it's really, really early. It's not even early for a real job, but for me, like, it's really, really early.
Hey, Owie, just moved to the East Coast or to Europe.
Yeah, screw that. Vancouver's the best.
Vancouver?
Number one.
Yeah, hey, who was trying to convince me of that?
Probably me.
No, it wasn't you. It wasn't
Conrad?
No, there was another loyalist Canadian there.
For Vancouver or Canada?
No, it was saying it only for Vancouver. He hated the rest of Canada. He just said Vancouver was good. Because Vancouver had like the only reasons he could give me was like Vancouver had food.
Yeah, it's really good food and it's pretty.
Yeah, that's it. That was the only two things he could give me and said it was the best place in the world just because it had food and it was pretty.
That's Vancouver.
And healthcare. And healthcare? Yeah, sorry.
And healthcare.
No, it's just America that robs you of healthcare.
Just America. Like,
there's countries which have real healthcare. Like, even here in Germany. While Germany may destroy me on taxes, the healthcare system here is really good. And in Australia, it's also, like, really cheap.
Yeah, it's actually everywhere with the States.
Because you guys, it's like, well, we're going to make it so that the jobs have a good healthcare package as a company package. I know all that jazz. Game time, though.
So, they picked Tidehunter, who was pretty spectacular against their lineup last game.
Yeah.
With the Void, which means that they're probably going to have a carry Void this game. Most likely. Honestly, this is sort of embarrassing, but is Arrow Dire or Radiant?
They're Radiant. You actually have it written on the top left and the bottom left.
Oh, there. Yeah, that is embarrassing, huh?
I won't hold
this big screen very much.
I won't hold it against you, man, because you never see this type of screen unless you're like spectating all the games. And I'm pretty sure most of the time you just jump over the big screen.
Yeah. Like, when replays, I look at the end pick screen, and then I take a screenshot or something, so.
Yeah. Even if you need to see, like, the bands and the picks and like, the order for it. Like, most of the order you could probably work out yourself, but even, like, the bands over on Join Dota, they're all done in the order the bands were done, so 1 to 5.
Yeah.
So you could already look it up from most of the match ticket pages in the community.
And I really like this Viper pick. He's, like, we saw, like, Void would chrono him and nothing would happen to him because like everyone doesn't want to get corrosive skin and stuff like that, and he's in the laning phase and overall in the game basically he destroys Tidehunter. He makes it obnoxious to fight because a lot of the times Viper is in the front, Tidehunter gets a good ravage, but everyone has to run past the Viper and he's just like this poison bat and he's putting his poison on everyone and no one can move forward to get like a good fight off. So he's an obnoxious hero and he just makes the laning phase super easy for Invasion Esports here. Rass the first pick. Dire side. He's pretty good at Roshan.
I'm really surprised, though, the way that Arrow are doing these drafts again. Again, they're crippling DDZ. You see the third and fourth bans coming out from Invasion. They ban out Tinker, they ban out Invoker.
I'm, like, from watching at TI, I'm surprised Invoker's not first banned versus him.
Yeah.
Because
but then again, like Arrow seems to be refusing to first pick him.
5 seconds remaining.
Or picking the first two. It's really unusual that Arrow are doing this, considering like third and fourth bans, you're sitting there going, well, they got a Void and a Tidehunter. I don't really care what else they pick up. Let me just take out signature annoying heroes like Tinker and Invoker.
really weird because Faceless Void Invoker would have been a super legit opening for them. You have Roshan scouting with the Forge Spirits. You have some push. You have the Chrono Sunstrike combo, which is always nice. And honestly, DDZ is one of the best invokers in the world, hands down. Like, watching him at TI was a treat.
Yeah. It was always the highlight whenever I cast Arrow as well, like watching DDZ play these style of heroes.
When he ruined America's dreams and just beat two American teams with Invoker. Crushed their hopes. This is great.
Oh, crushed hopes.
Crushed hopes, broken dreams.
But it's hilarious too. Like, everyone's like, they're never gonna win a game. Like, these guys should never win a game. And like, it's like they come through and then beat them. It's like, okay.
They weren't that bad, even though they went 2-2-13. Like,
yeah,
MUSC was like a whole tier below. But I mean, maybe Arrow was a tier below like the top Chinese teams, but they weren't like super far. Like, MUSC might have been two tiers between the top two, so TI3, right?
Yeah.
But like Arrow Gaming, like, they had some really good games versus some very good teams. They almost beat like DK and like
the amount of times they came close. I noticed that was one big thing that was coming out, at least from the commentator side of things, during the group stages. You weren't sitting there going every single game was one sided. A lot of the games were really, really close. 5 seconds
remaining. Yeah. They were a pushover for sure. Like, yeah. you didn't look at them and say, oh, hey, super free win. Like, there was a decent chance they were gonna come on top, especially if they did well in the draft.
I've always been an Arrow fan. Maybe actually, I've always been a DDZ fan. Because
who did he play with before Arrow? Do you know? Or
that's actually a really, really good question, and I'm having a mind blank right now.
His play on Arrow is really cool.
Before DDZ, he was part of LoYitNet. And a team called Three Kingdoms.
Okay. Yeah, I don't watch AC Dota, not gonna lie. We never played them, so I would never really watch them. Anyways, there's the combo you love.
Yes. Yes. It's amazing. I'm gonna write home about it.
You know, Ravage plus Scarathel is actually surprisingly good too. Like, you don't need that on the Chrono guy. Because a lot of times it feels like you get a good Chrono on them, and then you blow that Scarathel, and you actually didn't need that Scarathel to kill them. So, like, in the mid-late game, in the early game, like, you almost always need the Scarathel. But after a while, like, you can actually Chrono a few targets, and then you can hit the Scarathel on the Ravage target instead.
Mm-hmm.
And, like, because, like, it's a lot of times it's hard to hit, like, important squishy support in the Chrono. But when he's coming in to counter-initiate, you'll get him into Ravage, and then you can Scarathel that guy, and you get two really fast pickoffs in a team fight, and then it's 5v3. So, yeah, okay. Nature's prophet.
Yeah, not a hero I was expecting to see in this game. Like, up against Void, Tide, and Skywrath.
This is looking like last game. Like, Nature prophet builds sort of a bit more tanky, the damage from Arrow, even though they have a Skywrath, they have enough to kill one person, and then, like,
then they're spent.
You still have trees, you have wards, you have the one person you're killing is a viper, so you have this annoying flying poison bird hitting you and killing your towers and stuff. Like, it doesn't, like, they need to pick some really hard damage here, and I haven't really solved the viper issue.
They can't do that unless it has to be a mid solo hard damage then. But they could try and go for like Krob.
Ooh, Krob sounds good.
Because then they'll at least synergize with the Faceless Void, not to mention everything else they've got, but that'll give him the damage.
Sanking's a good pick. Yeah. That gives him a lot of damage here. And the Scarath Sanking combo is really good just because Scarath is so strong in lane that Sanking can do anything he wants. He's a pretty decent ganker, and he can jungle quite fast once he hits like that level 3. So I really, really like that pick. Another one could have been Earthshaker, but I think Sanking was better here.
If they went for the Earthshaker, then it's like it's a fissure into a Chrono, and that could cause you more problems than good.
10 seconds, it's also like a fissure with a Scarathel, which is super cool to see. Like, they fissure and just blow up the support at 1400 range, which is ridiculous. But yeah, the fissure and Chrono can often be sort of iffy. Reserve
time. Yeah.
I like the Sanking pick. It's good. I think the solo mid should have some carry potential still. I don't think you want to. What the hell?
I've actually got a feeling though that, yeah, I don't know why, but all right, no, that's okay.
It's pretty good.
This is actually going to be a Void solo mid. I'm actually having flashbacks right now to a couple of other Arrow games they casted, and DDZ is actually their faceless Void player they'll throw in towards the mid. So they're going to try and run Void versus Viper on the middle lane. 5 seconds. Leave the time for the off lane, then Skywrath SK plus one on the safe. Team
ban. So what's really cool with this Chen pick is that they have a Nature's Prophet to scout out if the enemy wards their jungle. So usually you can get a good sense of where they warded it, which makes it, even if they go in and ward, because I think Arrow has a superior level 1 right now.
Yes.
Like, you can probably deward it pretty easily. The Chen pick is super good against Void, Tidehunter, and Sand King, actually. He's good against AoE like that. We, it didn't work, obviously, but we had some anti-voice shots with Chen. But it didn't. Like, he makes it so that you should be able to kill anyone with Void, but you just barely can't because of Hand of God, and it ruins a lot of aspects about an offlane Void. If Void is mid, he might have a little bit more farm, so the counter might not be as good. But, even with that Sankia, I don't know, with a Chen, they might be able to force on 6 towers. I'm not convinced that they'll be able to break base if the Sankin gets a lot of farm. But, like, they have a good... Ooh.
Dire team. I take it back.
They have enough damage.
It is not a faceless Void mid. It is not a faceless Void mid.
Now, that's a good pick.
Now I'm actually wondering if Invasion have what it takes.
Do they have a really good Meepo player on Arrow?
I believe it's EDZ.
Okay.
I don't know if he's a really good Meepo player. I know. I think I've seen him play one Meepo before, and it was decent.
Okay. If they have a really good Meepo player, I don't think Invasion can win this game, actually. I think that pick was really, really strong.
5 seconds remaining. Because technically, like, everything Invasion has, like, beyond...
What the hell? What's wrong?
I don't know. I remember. I'm going to quote from the Book of No Tale. So, Book of No Tale, Chapter Meepo, Verse 1. If the enemy has AoE controls, do not pick Meepo. If the enemy has single target focus fire with AoE controls, do not pick Meepo. If those two aren't, if rule one and rule two don't apply, pick Meepo. That's the Book of No Tale right there. And it's exactly there. Where's the control? Where's the control and where's the damage directly into a Meepo?
Like, when you pick Meepo against a lot, if you get Meepo last pick against something like this, he's disgustingly OP. Remaining. Like, he's actually just gross. Like, it's like Earth Spirit unnerfed. And yeah, I don't know. Like, I don't get why they want to pick Lysir into something like this. Like, Tidehunter's really good versus him. Void is really good versus him.
Earthbind even goes over the top of Rage, doesn't it?
Sorry?
Do you break free with Rage, like Earthbind? Because I think that goes through immunity too.
No, it doesn't. But Geostrike goes through, so you're pretty much 100% slowed anyways. The Geostrike's Earthbind's a bit weird. I saw on a Dota quiz that Ghost Scepter takes it off, but I actually don't think that's true. And I think BKB takes it off. And something that's really weird, that's just a random thing, is like, if you Earthbind someone and they TP, if you Earthbind them before your first Earthbind wears out, then it refreshes Earthbind but doesn't stop their TP. So you need to actually wait for it to stop and then you can re-Earthbind them. I've lost a kill like that. It's quite sad.
This bottom lane, one Trinket came down, scouted out all of, at least 3 players of Arrow. But it also would have scared at the fact that Morrison's walking around with an Observer Ward and 2 sentries, which means Invasion know their jungle belongs to them. And in fact, even look at the ward here from Arrow. I'm not sure about this one here, but when you're running a Tide offlane, wouldn't you try and put a ward up in this little region just to the east of the top lane area?
Are you talking about his hill ward?
Yeah.
The rune ward?
Yeah, because he's put a hill ward up there. Okay, he got a haste ring, which is wonderful for him.
I don't think he needs a vision ward just because he's only against a Rasta Lifesteer. If you're against a Trilane, like, they can kill you really easily, but Rasta Lifesteer can't really kill him. And if Chen comes, he's probably going to smoke anyways. So I think the vision... Like, they need a rune ward, I think, pretty much. And they wanted a lane ward, apparently. So he's pretty much forced to put that there.
Oh, Tidehunter.
Oh, that's cute.
Mr. Hastering can still drag the creep wave down, so he'll get a free experience right now.
Yeah. It's really weird that he's doing this, because if you just block really well on Radiant, you get a free wave of EXP anyways. Like, they can't stop it, because you're your block is just so easy on Radiant side. And weird, like Meepo versus Viper, I actually think if it's a pure 1v1, Meepo actually wins that. He's actually really strong in lane.
Well, the only thing which would change it from being a pure 1v1 is an impact of Chen. But Chen would then need like a Wild Wing or a Harpy or something like that to stop it. But they're actually smoking. We have a level 1 smoke. Ooh, coming out from both Chen as well as Shaman.
They know that, yeah. They need to stomp on this Meepo. I don't know if he dies to this, though.
I know it's even a problem if he does die. Sorry.
Oh, he went... Are they going to the enemy jungle? Oh, this is cute.
Wait, so they're going to run down, try and gank up on bottom lane? I suppose I can see everything because of these treants, so they know Mozen and MTR are here.
Okay. They smoked a little bit early, so Meepo is about to see them.
Well, Meepo's got no proof to go out to, but they should be able to get the kill. Oh, the Earth Bind.
Oh, no.
He actually had it mid-air when they went for the Shackles. Now, this Sentinel's going to chase in, but the Sentinel's going to die. It gets a hoof stomp off, but DDZ's still got bottle charges here. He's going to poof the Sentinel down, bottle charge up, gets his level 3. Yeah, 28 life points back out over the mid. At the same time, Skywrath and MTR rotated in.
And like, look at the Spheron, he's still so scared. And look at the Tidehunter, he doesn't care. He's at the enemy tier 1. Like, that smoking was sort of...
Tide's actually like, winning on CS really. On the top lane too because of that.
Yeah, Tidehunter's really, really strong. You can't leave a melee against him almost anyone. Like, Lysia's one of the better ones, but still, like, Tidehunter hurts. And minus 6% damage is just ridiculous.
DDZ's already brought back his full life point Meepo. Send it back and he just proofs in.
Yeah, the thing is, the ganks on Viper are actually really easy for a Meepo, plus anyone, like Garth or Sank.
Lifesteal is hitting with mittens on this top lane. It's just Tanker smashing Tidehunter. He's doing 28 damage per hit.
Do you see that? He has 260 HP and he runs back and gets the last hit. And he doesn't care because he's Tidehunter. Like, that's what Tidehunter does on lane.
It's a shame he can't be running a bottle or anything else.
Yeah, and the thing is, like, that gank, it, like, Rasta's level 2, Chen's level 2, and Tidehunter's level 4, and their Furion had to be scared that entire time because he didn't over support
Viper,
him, so he's only level 2.
He's battling up against EDZ, there's not another proof just yet, but this 5% of 68 life points, DDZ's bottling back up again. He knows he can reinsert if he can get an Earthbind, because it was the Earthbind that started all of that. He Earthbinded up once, and then brought his secondary Meepo in on the proof once he realized the Earthbind was able to connect. And then with the secondary
problem
proof
with this
he
lane is that Viper has to play aggressive. But because he's playing aggressive, if he's a 285 movement speed hero that's really easy to Earthbind, and anyone who comes in kills him, a level 1 Skywrath with Silence can come in and kill him. Like, that's how easy it is to kill that Viper in that scenario.
But how are you meant to get the advantage up against a Meepo? Because like, you have to go all the way back to base to heal, and DDZ just got to tag team his Meepos back and forward.
Yeah, Meepo's actually just a ridiculous hero, to be honest. Like, if he can play this Meepo really well, I honestly don't see them losing this. It looks really good for him. And like, Void has uncontested free farm, Radiant's top tower is which is always attack. Scary. Furion, Nyx got really heavily contested actually by that Tidehunter, even though like the CSs are sort of similar. The regen isn't, like he bought two sets of regen, he used all, he has no more regen on Lysteer. He wants to go Midas quickly,
Ghost.
But...
Ghost? Oh man. Sorry, MTR actually just did something which may harm him in the future. He put the second point into Burrow Strike so we could try and reach the Nature's Prophet with a Burrow Strike.
That's actually really big, because he can't jungle now.
Yep. Oh, at least not straight away. But considering the control over this bottom lane, I don't think he's got too much of a problem with it.
I think and the Meepo should share the XP. Anyway. He should share XP of the stacks with the supports. Because he gets level 25 too quickly, actually.
It's an interesting point, because normally you just say, oh man, make sure Meepo gets everything. But if you're looking into the later portion of the game, remember the supports, people. Dyer's
bottom tower they're important.
MTR's moving up. He's meant to get a good creep wave drag off, but at the same time, now the creep wave's just between the two towers. With a Burrow strike onto Ghost, they could even kill him off, just a leap to Burrow.
That's really scary under the tier 2, though, just because...
Now you're worried
Ghost
about TP support?
Like he went for a quick Midas, so it's not like he has treads or something on the Void.
True. There's not a lot of damage coming out of this guy. His movement speed's actually quite pathetic. But I suppose at the same time, he doesn't really care, because he knows the Tidehunter's getting a hell of a lot of farm anyway. And this Chen is... like, we're almost 6 minutes into the game, and we have a level 3.5 Chen. He doesn't really have a lot to show for it. He's ganking with a Wild Wing.
Yeah, I'm not too sure their plan is here. To be perfectly honest, I mean, they can shackle that Void, but...
middle lane, they're going to try and go for first blood. Nope, they can't reach him. Viper's backed up to the tier 1 tower. But it's these Meepos which are split across the map. We've got one DDZ on the bottom lane, and we've got one DDZ in the mid. And we're actually going to have more DDZ as well, because he's got illusion runes. Tide will TP bottom lane. Oh, okay, this Ravage, let it go! He couldn't let it go! The Void jumps in though, but the Earthbind, the Ravage. Okay, that was a bit of a waste. The Shadow Shaman still goes down, and First Blood goes to the Tidehunter because of it.
That was unfortunate. He had a really big snap three-man Ravager, and they actually would have killed all three of them.
Yep.
The Meeple Buffian. They still get one, which is... I think that was mediocre. Actually, it was okay, just because Chen and Rasta had to rotate all the way down there. They rotated all the way down, and then now they're rotating all the way back up. So, for so long, they didn't do anything, but they used all three cores on Arrow Gaming to do that.
At the same time, I don't think they really care too much about that, because you've still got Skywrath now getting space in the mid for his levels, which is really important. Like, Meepo should almost just stay in the jungle right now and make sure Skywrath gets level 6.
Yeah, he really should, honestly. Like, that Skywrath 6 is going to be huge this game. Like, Sand King, when the two supports can kill anyone on the other team except for Viper, I actually think they can kill Lysior quite easily. It's really big. And, yeah, and Lysior, because he got pressured so much early, he had to go for phase boots.
Middle lane. Viper's being initiated on DDZ, however. He's Viper-striked up, but now they're going to bring in more help, which is Lifesteal. DDZ will die here with the Infest damage as well. He ensured the kill, but it also becomes a tier 1 for a tier 1 tower trade. This is going on.
That was a really big misplay by the Meepo there. He had Poof up on the Hurt one, and if he ran away his Void P1 while Poofing to it, he would have survived there. And then you have had a Lysteel who TP'd mid, and like, what's he do from there? He's not gonna farm. He already had to go phase boots instead of Midas. It would have been a really big play for him. Dire's
bottom tower is Fortunately for Arrow Gaming fans, doesn't come off that way. Attack. Now middle lane, they seal up the Lifestealer, but he just, with phase boots, able to run himself away to safety. That is probably one other thing which you probably flag pretty highly, that Lifestealer, Mr. I have BKB from level 1, doesn't really have that when Mosin's able to get that seal off very early on.
Yeah, it's really big, and if you're coming in smoked with the Sand King Stun and Ancient Seal, a lot of times you can catch a Lifesteal, especially at night.
Oh, Chen.
Ooh.
Question mark. DXB was like, well, I want to leap the Chen, but I know he's going to deny the rune. And then Chen's like, I just want to leave here. But then they both turned around after they both thought it was not worth it.
Look at this Wildkin, he's going around the world. He's going on an adventure. And this Chen's impact is just, it hasn't been there. Just because, like, he failed the first gank. They failed the first gank, and then I think he started panicking. He's like, oh shit, I need to do something. When, to be honest, like, he really just needed to farm up at least level 5. So they could, if they pushed a few towers, then maybe they have a better chance if they can take Roshan and sort of snowball off there. But, I sort of understand, because Meepo is scary. He's really scary to play against.
MTR staring down this Viper in the mid. With level 3 Burrow Strike, he knows he has pretty good reach. Especially when he has the Invis coming out from Sandstorm. But no one's giving an opening for it, and DDZ is just continuously farming inside the jungle.
And they have Ravage on Tide, and he's 600 from mech. When they get that mech, like, Invasion really wants to be the one pushing, but once Tidehunter has that mech, I don't think you can push against that anymore.
He can farm that mech too, with a triple stack of Ancients. It'll be
very
easy.
That's really good.
Yeah, DDZ's even going to snipe a regeneration rune. That's also not just a regen, it's a regen into a bottle. Which means he's got the regen for his initial Meepo with three bottle charges for each other's. And Tide's coming in the mid. So, staring down, it's a Shadow Shaman at level 5.5. He's not going to survive this. They steal him, they gush him, They borrow with the Anchor Smash. Skyro's already got the kill. That TP in. I don't know if it's even worth cancelling that one because Earthbind, there's Orb Effects, but the Ravage still being up. It's after the Anchor Smash, there goes your one charges. The Chen will be able to pick up the Sand King in the meantime, but DDZ, that Meepo was really low and does go down. They're going to lose him into the TP Sprout. There's no mana left on the Tunnator. He already used all of his stick charges. But with Void coming in with the Chrono, gonna be a little bit more cautious about this because Skywrath, he's still at level 6, so they don't have a Mystic Flare combo yet.
And the thing is, this Skywrath really should be level 6. And, like, that was honestly a weird fight. Like, you're 500, 400 away from a mech on Tide. You know they're Viper as mech, and you decide to take that fight. Like, it's sort of weird to dive a tier 1 like that to just kill a Rasta. And how Rasta died, that's actually the worst way to die as a support. Like, fueling as a support, because, like, you're almost level 6 and you really want it, but you know you might die.
Mm-hmm.
Like, that's the worst feeling. But, like, his death was actually really good there because he baited him in and he's getting space at top to get his level 6. He's going to get it off this creep wave and, yeah, it's looking pretty good since they wasted Ravage. They should be able to take a tower with a level 6 since they have no Ravage.
Well, especially because Chen's getting up in his levels too, so he could finally have a bigger army. So you have both Mass Serpent Wards as well as having Treants as well as having a Chen army. And then you get a Lifesteal and a Viper who seem to also be very much ready to fight. You got Look Mech as this. Well as Cloak even over on that Viper.
Yeah,
and Jerome's Lifesteal.
Crosser Skin, Planeswalker, and his natural resistance with a Mech. Like, that guy's tanky.
You're liking his build too? 2-2-4-1?
Yeah, I think that's pretty good. I personally, I like 3-1-4, but like, everyone goes 2-2-4, so I'm probably wrong there. It's just because I only play Viper in pubs, and in pubs it's easier to snowball when you have 3 poison.
Does another toxin why do you keep another toxin at level 1?
I like 1 point just because I'm bad at last hitting. It actually does a lot of damage to heroes.
Is that the only reason why?
No, I'm just kidding.
Logic 4. Right, we saw it during game number 1. I think that was the reason why I went the 4 points nether toxins. It's like, well, it's first game of the day. I'm not really feeling the mojo right.
Fuck this shit. I don't want to miss that CS. But no. In all honesty, like, I think nether toxin on paper is a lot of damage. But I think what Viper adds to a fight doesn't come purely from that nether toxin damage. I think it comes from applying slows and disrupting the fight and making it annoying to fight against, mm-hmm. which I think poison attack does a lot better. Of course, cross the skin is the most important for that.
So you're more about the kiting kind of style as opposed to just the straight up, well, my enemy will bring you low so I get more damage.
Yeah, I think so. And I don't really like the cloak, to be honest. If you have level 4 cross of skin, I think the cloak gives you like 8-9 extra spell resistance or something. Like, I don't think it's worth it.
Uh-huh.
I mean, it still reduces 15% of the damage you take, but I think, like, in terms of EHP, like, for 550, I think a Bow of Giant Strength will give you more. I might be wrong, but you're also taking some damage from physical and stuff, too.
Mm-hmm. I just want to say, too, while we're tuning in here, guys, please use multi-twitch if someone wants to make one for those. Keep tuning in here, obviously, because we've got more action coming your way. But please go over to join.blue. So it's twitch.tv/join.blue if you're looking for the easy direct link. Go to join.com and it's clicked up there. Capitalist is casting the MSI Chinese Open Qualifiers. Now, normally say Open Qualifiers, you're not really going to be happy about that. But at the same time, the Chinese Open Qualifiers normally give us really high quality Dota. So please go over there and watch both the live streams. Cap's over there streaming on join.blue. He's been live for a little bit now. So yeah, please go support Cap as he streams. He's also got the I-League matches coming up there later today. Looks like mid-prep's
going to be in. They're pushing
with
mid-tower. They have the level 6 on Rasta.
And that
voice
position is almost perfect. Oh no, it's not anymore. He was considering a jump in, but has to jump out.
Yeah, they can't fight this. This tower should go down.
Well, they look like they're in a position like they still want to fight it, because Tide's very, very far up here. The Centaur Stomp won't go. They use the fortification. The Meepo is slowly rotating back out of the jungle in towards the mid. Ty's still on the front lines, but that Prophet Oli doing a lot of bonus damage, but this Void, you know what he wants? He just wants to leap in and grab the four guys, but he won't get the Viper, which he has to, doesn't he? Or else the Mech's just going to keep the rest of his team alive.
But that was really weird. Like, Viper's off to the side instead of just standing in front of being Viper.
Tide, you're so far up. The Centaur hoofs them. He's in the river. Oh, okay, no. Matt Servant wards are very far out of position. The Viper getting sealed up. Now the Mystic Flare's going to go, but Viper's going to tank that. Triggers his own mech, and now he can turn into the fight. They use the Sprout to protect him and use the Chen to send him back. Okay.
Oh my god. So they were getting super greedy there. They didn't want to drop wards for the tower because they wanted to take Roshan right after. But because they didn't drop wards, they're feeding wards, and then the tower's just going to get denied for free. Like, if Viper stood in front, he literally could not die there. Like, they could have... Or if he died, they're going to kill, like, a lot of people in return for him. Because, like, with a Hand of God, a Planeswalker, level 4 corrosive, a mech, he doesn't have a magic stick, which sort of hurts him, but, like, he's incredibly tanky right now.
They haven't denied this mid-tower, and there's only an SK sitting next to it. Tide hit it once to bring it down a little bit. I don't know if they changed their mind halfway through.
It's sort of cute. You can, like, with Ravage Up, you can maybe bait a fight around it, and also, like, 100 gold now is a lot more than 100 gold later, so by just delaying a little bit, you might delay one of their items. I mean, it's only 100 gold for the die, but what's going on?
I don't know! 32! And now 1! Wait.
Ooh, he's, like, he's sneaky, you know? I don't know.
It's only 32 life points, everybody! Prophet, come on in! TP, have a great time! No.
And Sand King.
I still can't believe the Tide never. He was out so far. It ended up being so legendary what he did.
Yeah, it was. Like, I guess they didn't take a Ravage timer. They thought he had Ravage and he was running in like that because everyone was like, holy shit, there's a Tide Hunter running at me. Like, I'm gonna back away now, but. Yeah, and the smoke's from.
It's Roshan. It's got to be for a Roshan. They're not coming in for towers right now. They're going to go for a gank of bottom?
I think they're going for a kill with that smoke.
They can't kill Meepo, though. They got to know they can't kill Meepo.
They can get him.
He just poofed in, so they have a chance for it.
They got him.
Yep.
Oh, no. That's right before Zaganims.
Can't poof out.
Loses. Yep. He lost 330 gold there.
I don't think it's going to take him that long to get it back up again. Then again, I'm not seeing many stacks inside of his own jungle anymore.
Yeah, he cleared them all, and...
No one's
like,
ever
it's actually a problem for SK, because, like, when you see Zai playing SK, he'll have his blink, like, 9-10 minutes, but because he took that level to Burrow Strike and the Meepo's taking a lot of space, he can't get that. Ooh, are they TPing to defend this bottom?
It looks like it, but
they... They cancel three. So they got a tower and 3 TPs.
Well, that just blows like
that's
400
huge.
Gold of arrows, and
yeah. It's not even just that. It's like you can't TP now on 3 heroes, which is huge.
Yeah, if they wanted, they could even just force bottom lane, but they've already TP back. Like Life Steal is up on the top lane. The Meepo is actually farming up the Dire jungle
Dire's
of all places.
Top tower is under attack.
But Viper's up here with the Life Steal. And what? The hero who doesn't have Infest. Who doesn't have a move like a high movement ability is they just do it that way when Mosin when Mosin walks in point blank like that. That works, and then goes Sprouts on the Tide Hunter. They got him shackled up as well. He's got Ravage. He'll have to use it if he wants to survive this, but he makes the decision to hold on to it for the next fight. Two quick kills. They hold their tier 1 tower in the top lane, and nothing else is really lost.
That's a 285 movement speed hero Lifesteal bombing by running at someone. That's sick. And mid, all Chen's creeps, all Chen's so sad. Oh my god.
I'm waiting for DDZ though to lose one of these Meepos. That Prophet Ulti's gonna bounce through him pretty damn hard. The Shadow Blast off cooldown in 3 seconds time. And the Viper, okay, that's the right choice. They split up. Okay, when Void jumps in like this, the Shadow Blast was still there. I don't know if they can kill him or not. He got the mech up before the fight began. Now Hand of God as well. Okay, they can with the Skywrath coming in, but the Shadow Blast, it's a double kill. The Blast kills the Meepo. The basic attack kills the Sand King. Most powerful unit in the 17-minute mark, the Shadow Tormentor.
That was, he chronoed his Sand King's epicenter.
Oh, did he?
Yeah.
Uh-oh.
That's unfortunate.
Didn't even notice that one.
And it's just barely. It was like 0.1 seconds on epicenter. So that was really good for invasion. Like, I thought Viper was... Like, I thought they were going to TP in with Fear. Oh, they're going for Roshan. Oh, this is cute. I like this.
Well, make the most of the opportunity. You get yourself You get yourself kills. You got mass open wards, and you've already got an army of... both not only just treants, but you've also got the necro units. Why not force it?
Yeah, but that's a free Roshan.
Yeah.
Completely uncontested. And DDZ finally has an Ignis.
Lifestealer.
Roshan has fallen to the dark.
What's up?
Okay, it was intentional. They sent Lifestealer back before Roshan died. He got none of the bonuses for it. He was just going back to pick up his armlet by the looks of it.
Yeah, they don't like him. They don't want him to have EXP. But to be honest, I think that's good because like he's already level 11, and like the three heroes on the right of Invasion are all level 8, so that Roshan EXP is big for them actually.
Yeah.
Like ideally, you would have Viper not get EXP either, but you want to pick up that Aegis because, you know, it's scary not to. And there's actually a DD top unscouted, and I like this from Hero. They're sharing the EXP from the Ancients, which is nice. Maybe if they could give Sankey his Blink here. Nope. No Blinkerino.
He's still short. That might really still bite him in the ass. That's a level 3 Necro book already over on Ghost. Like, no hand of Midas for a profit, which is really unconventional. Midas. He just went straight in for the Necro books.
I think they wanna... that says they really wanna end the game, but like, look at it. He has a Necro 8, a Necro 3 at level 8. Necro 8, holy shit.
It's some good farm, and it could actually really bite the like the Meepo in the back. If he ends up killing off that Necro unit, he's going to have
and
a Meepo drop very, very low.
Yeah, he's definitely going to kill it, and that's half a health on one of the Meepos.
Yep.
Plus a Fear note, like that's almost a dead Meepo.
Yep. With two things which you don't have to put your hero in the line of fire to use.
That's really good. Like, especially as like if one Meepo gets low and you start attacking with that Nether Toxin. Ooh, Viper. He has interesting items. He has a Belt of Strength and then he has a Mithril Hammer. I'm not too sure why he doesn't want to finish his treads here.
Huh? Maybe he bought the Mithril Hammer thinking he's gonna. No, not even thinking he's going to die. SK's about to initiate on top. Epicenter. This time it won't get chronoed. Blink. Burrow. They get the Mystic Flare as well. And they evaporate Ghost, but they just used a hell of a lot to get these kills. So TP out going to go from both SK as well as the Sky Rat, and there is no stuns to stop this at all. So both will get away with murder.
They actually made a huge play there. Both the top farmers on Invasion, maybe not the top farmers, I haven't been checked. So yeah, the two top farmers Invasion rotated up top to try to catch two supports. They got out and they got a pick off on another core. Like that's actually so huge. Really well played by them. So much space. If you look at the net worth, it's actually really far ahead for Arrow here.
Yeah, Meepo and Void are a very, very long way forward. There's even a Crystallis with a Mask of Madness on that Void. Now DXP, he needs some help, and he's got it. Ravage goes out, and he can even Chrono over onto the two heroes. The Burrow Strike comes in. There's no Epicenter, remember, it was used before, but the Chen's already going to get beated down after Shadow Shaman's gone down. Ooh. Hand of God got off, and that's actually going to delay the fight just a little bit too long. But the Void will end up falling here as well as the SK. So it's a core and a support for two supports. And they'll push in towards this middle lane. Arming and Necro units. They have Centaurs. They have Satyrs. They don't have the mech, but they have the Aegis, the Immortal over on the Viper. And the Lifesteal is still ready to fight. This should be a tier 2 tower down because there's no Ravage. There's no real way for Arrow to fight this. Oh, maybe Meepo wants to. Actually, look at his position. He could actually do it like a blink to poof right now. If he wanted to try and have a crack at triggering the Viper's Axe. Oh no, he found a different one.
Die.
He found the Nature's Prophet. And that's going to be Ghost. He went off by himself. Just traveled north and got picked off.
Like, these net worths are so in favor of Arrow, but like, last game they were sort of in favor of Arrow too. And like, the pushing power and pushing potential of Evasion was just so high.
Yeah.
The only thing is, I don't know about the Lifesteal as a carry, to be honest, though. Like, I feel like... But, like, I can't think off the top of my head what hero else they could have gone. Ooh, Chen just picked up that haste. Yeah.
There is another way to look at this Lifestealer. Like, when you think about it with the Meepo, like, single target focus is going to be great for him. So, if he's able to build into something else, like, I don't know if he wants to go Desolator or, like, straight-up damage coming out of this Lifestealer. But to battle up against just killing off one Meepo, like that's the only objective right now, is to kill off one Meepo.
Yeah, it's definitely good. Usually you need some sort of AoE lockdown to do that, which he's a bit lacking, because if the Meepo is really good and he attacks your Lifesteal with all his Meepos and drags one back, which is sort of easy to do against a melee hero.
Yeah.
Like, Lysia starts moving at 100 move speed.
But then again, maybe if you go something else like a basher into Abyssal.
Yeah, that would be pretty good. Like, he needs that lockdown for sure.
Infest was just used by Lifestealer too. He's going to be a little bit more cautious on this middle lane. While on bottom lane, it looks like a trap's been set. We got Chen, Shadow Shaman, as well as Aegis Prophet all inside the trees. But this is happening while four heroes are preparing to fight on mid. I say four because Meepo is still pushing at the top. He's got his Blink Meepo in the tree line there. And now they move down. Open wounds. Ooh. Chrono already. Lifestealer. Well, they're going to drop everything they've got. The hammer drops, but the Ravage comes in from the Tidehunter as well. And DDZ, how quick do these Meepos arrive? The buyback comes from the Lifestealer, but the T1 tower's already gone down. The TP will complete here from the Lifestealer. As you know, looks like he ends up cancelling at the last moment. They'll accept the fact that they'll lose both the Viper as well as the Chen. And I think at this point, a tier 2 tower to boot. Great fight for Arrow.
Yep. They actually just got wrecked there. I don't think there's no way to put it really. Like, Meepo's out of control at this point. I don't think he can. Like, I don't think they can do anything for Meepo. They don't have any damage, honestly. And when that Lystra was going down, Chen actually had 1 second left on Hand of God right before the Lystra died, so that's sort of unfortunate.
Blink.
If he got it off.
Oh, he got the Earth Binds. He caught Ghost out. Oh, that's actually gonna be more critical.
So fast.
Yeah. But you've already got an Aghanim Scepter with an ultimate orb over on the Meepo. If this does become a Skadi, the stats on the Meepos is just ridiculous.
I think it should be a Hex, to be honest.
It should be what? A Hex?
I'd like to see a Hex.
If Viper had a BKB, if Viper had a BKB, then I'd understand it. And now he actually picks up the BKB.
Like, you can definitely kill a. It's very easy to get Rage and BKB off.
Wait, what? How'd that miss?
I don't know.
That looked pretty damn good.
I think that was like a server leg for us. Like, maybe in theirs it looked different, but like for us it probably...
Maybe. Yeah, but it kind of looked like the Burrow Strike could have connected on two.
I think, yeah, it's a Hex here. And I think Blink Hex is probably the strongest combination in Dota. Because you have like a total of 2.2k range or whatever, and it's instant. And it's like you can't CC out of it or whatever.
Ooh. Oh, Chen. Gosh, time lock, a Chronos, and he actually managed to get both the Chen as well as the Shadow Shaman. Burrow Strike to make sure the Shadow Shaman has to remain where he is, but Void, he's going to go down for all of this. And MTR might join as well, while the Skywrath, well, they're battling over on the side. It's the Viper whose 10-second BKB is already gone. Actually, the Burrow Strike away for the SK was successful, and now Earthbind and the Aegis Prophet's going to get completely wiped. MTR got away from the Necro unit, and they actually managed to Earthbind as well on the Viper. The boost back up again to the Viper. And that's a full team wipe. And GG, well played, 25 minutes in. And Arrow will take game number two, forcing us to a third deciding game between Arrow and Invasion before we go into our third series of the day, which will be Zephyr going up against Johnny's Revenge, formerly known as Arrow, after Johnny actually got kicked from actually the team we're casting right now. It's gonna be some revenge when those two guys, if they can meet in the finals. But that's a rough run. Either way, game two over, game three up soon. Stay tuned, we'll be back.